So I'm Coach Toko.
My name is David Mahosky. I'm the assistant lacrosse coach at Rondout Valley.
My name is Alec Toko. I was on the first ever varsity lacrosse team in 2012. February of 2022, I accepted the position of director of lacrosse operations at Brown University.
I was a teacher at Rondout Valley High School for 34 years. I started in the fall of 1988. I want to say that I was the longest continuous coach at Rondout. I coached a sport from the fall of 1986. I'm still coaching at Rondout, actually, after I've retired.
I've been coaching with Tony Toko. Since 2004, we used to coach in Kingston together. Then we came at Rondout Valley and we started a program here. We started as a club and we officially became a program in 2012. And I've been with the Ganders since it started.
As far as lacrosse goes, me and another gentleman who passed away started the first lacrosse program in Section 9 at Kingston High School back in 1990. I coached at Kingston for almost 20 years. I was the head coach there for 10, the assistant coach for 10, and then brought the program here to Rondout. Well, in 2008, we had a club team that played two games, and then in 2009, we had a full schedule, but played it as a club team. We had our first varsity team in 2012.
We went to the sectional title every year I played, lost in 2012. First year team, we really didn't have too much of an expectation going into that season. We just wanted to compete and not embarrass ourselves being a first year varsity team. So we were playing Walk Hill in our first ever varsity game, and like we were a ragtag bunch of guys. We were down, we were losing like I think like 12-5, 12-6 or something. Walk Hill was walking by our bench saying like, "Oh, welcome to Section 9, Rondout." And we were like, "All right, so just set the fire to our flame." And we came back and won the game, and it was our first game ever as a varsity program, and Walk Hill had like won the sectional title a couple of years earlier, and I think they won it that year. And I remember seeing one of their guys like pick up a lacrosse ball and just chuck it across the field, across the road, and I'm like, all right, this is how our story begins. The evolution of where we have begun to where we are now is just, it's awesome.
You know, you always want to be humble, be gracious in both victory and defeat, but I guess the numbers are what the numbers are. Wins and losses. As the head coach, I have a overall record of 230 wins and 98 losses, which are pretty good numbers. I'm not accustomed, except for maybe two times, well, one time up to that point, that I had a losing season. And the one losing season I had, we still won the section. Which seems kind of crazy. In 2016, I intentionally scheduled a very tough schedule. We didn't fare really well, so it got to a point where all we had to do was make the playoffs. And our philosophy was, make the playoffs, we're gonna win two games. Make the playoffs, win two games. We made the playoffs, we won the section. And then from there on in, not to be funny, the rest is history. We have a set of core values and we set objectives and we work very hard. And so I am going to talk about the greatest team that never was. It was really the 2020 season that didn't happen. Our vision started to come back around to the way it had been in, 2014 and 2015 and 2016 and our consistent expectations for excellence, expectations of excellence. And we had four practices and then the world stopped and it was very difficult. And when that happened, it threw a real monkey wrench into the system that we had developed here. Because we didn't have a JV team, we didn't have a modified team. Kids would play in our youth program. And then the younger guys, if we sucked at the classified eighth graders, and ninth graders practice with the varsity and we get them on the field when we can, but then they learn and are mentored from the older guys. But I knew we had a team that worked well together and that had a drive. 2020 rolls around, the season that doesn't happen. In 2021, my veterans had been eighth graders in 2019, 20, freshmen as 2020, and now we basically missed two seasons, right? We didn't have a season and then a whole other year, and we have our... I did not have experienced players. I didn't have guys that were accustomed to being on the field and in tough situations. You know, and like Coach Moskin, I like to say, you know, winning can become, you know, addictive, you know, right? Losing can also become, you know, habit forming. Losing, winning, you need to become, if you become accustomed to losing, that's a tough cycle to break out of. And when you become accustomed to winning through your level of play, that's a good thing too. When we were stuck, and it was a really pivotal point.
But really with Rondell Lacrosse, you have to trust the process, trust the coaching staff, just do your job and things will work out. So
in 2021, we won, I'm going on my memory now, what, we won 3 games?
I always said it was like a JV team, to be honest. You had freshmen and sophomores playing in roles that juniors and seniors usually do, so.
But the rough thing was, we lost 3 games, 2 of them in overtime, 1 of them in double overtime, and 1 of them by a goal. Just so we had three heartbreaker losses, and that it really kind of, well, it helped us set the tone for 2022. We took our lumps, and when you have a season like that, it's kind of a defining moment for programs. You have to decide where you're going to go, right? And I like to say we have a program. A program has a core set of values. They have a common goal. They have strong work ethic. They worry about each other before they worry about themselves, right? Team first, teammate second, self last. And they committed, we committed in the off season from the jump. As soon as the 2021 season ended, we could have sat around and cried about it, but instead we really got on it.
I knew they had something special going into that next season. So that summer, we started the Ridge Lacrosse program, and I didn't know how long it was going to last due to the fact where I didn't know where I was going to be in 6 months. So I just wanted to do my part and let these kids, the Rondout players, stay together for the summer, kind of teach and coach our culture within that program in the summer so we don't skip a beat. So I knew going into the 2022 season, even if I wasn't there, not even in the same state, I knew that they were going to have a really high level of success. So I really followed closely.
2022 can't happen if 2020 and 2021 doesn't happen. It kind of was a character builder and kind of a gut check for us to see what we're made out of.
This year, I had the ability to come work back in the high school. I was working in the middle school for a bit, and I was presented an opportunity to come to the high school. I went back to the high school, and I was seeing Coach Toko daily basis. You know, we normally talk often, but now I was seeing him throughout the day.
My dad was sitting with me in December. He was like, I don't know who's going to be my assistant coach. I'm like, I bet if you ask Coach Mahosky, he would come back.
So Coach Mahosky and I, you know, take a 1-2 punch. Coach Mahosky, his first year at Rondout would have been 2004-05. I talked him into coming in, coaching with me at Kingston. Obviously a guy with a huge amount of cachet as far as his lacrosse prowess, for lack of a better word, goes. I mean, he's well known in the lacrosse community. I was lucky enough to have him. I count him as one of my best friends. So Coach and I did a couple seasons together at Kingston. And then when I left, Kingston came here, kind of marched through with me with the club for 3 years, and then was on board with the varsity program, and we met with a very high degree of success. And then when his daughter came along, he kind of bid a farewell for a while, and then I asked him to come back for what I knew was going to probably be my last season.
And Tony threw the idea out. Tony and I have been coaching for many years together, and I took a break from the varsity level, and he threw it out, and he said, hey, it's my final year coaching, my final year teaching. What do you think we get the band back together? And I think that's verbatim what he said to me. Let's get the band back together. And I went, that's not a bad idea.
And so it was great putting the band back together, so to speak, because we have one of the things that has always been the case for Coach Mahosky and I. And I think it's part of the formula, the secret sauce of why we're such a successful program. We have a lot of fun, we laugh a lot, and we enjoy practice, we enjoy each other's company.
I kind of had an itch to go back to varsity. I just had to break that to my wife, who I promised that I wouldn't go back to varsity. Eventually, it was just the right thing to do. And seeing Toko every day, and then we started talking about lacrosse every day, and we saw a lot of the seniors that we had, and it was his final hurrah. And we talked about things that we didn't accomplish as co-coaches and with our program, some of the things that we kind of wanted to get done in a year. And some of the things when I punched out from the varsity level, some of the things that I thought we missed out on. So, you know, sitting down with Toko, he threw it out there. Let's get 1 year back together of coaching. We put some goals out there, personal goals with us, and obviously team goals.
Like thunder and lightning coming back together, and there's no other coaching duo like Coach Toko and Coach Mahosky, because they bring two different perspectives of the game to make one great coaching staff. It's just a perfect duo. It's Michael Jordan, Scottie Pippen, and Steph Curry and Clay. Coach Toko Mahosky is definitely up in that conversation. So it was like a storybook ending.
And the ball kind of got rolling with that. And there was a lot of fire that kind of got going between him and I again. We found that fire to kind of push the program. And it was very exciting moving back to the high school and being around just a great group of guys I was seeing on a daily basis walking around with sticks. So they motivated me. Toko motivated me. And it just seemed like the right thing to do was to get back together with him and one last hoorah with our program. I mean, the program's still going, but just with me and Toko and the boys.
Almost like a movie ending to bring him back for the last season, the way it went.
Start of the season, it was a little bit different for me this year. I took some time off, and I actually, with this group of guys, this is one of the few groups of lacrosse players that I didn't work with tremendous. I didn't put a lot of time in with. I was at a varsity level. They were younger. And as they were coming up, I started removing myself from that level. So I kind of missed them. So when I came back coaching with Toko and we took care of everything, it was in the beginning of the year, I kind of had to get a sense of the team I was working with. And they also had to get a sense of me. So there was a little bit of a feeling of, you know, I knew a lot of the guys, the Josh Newman.
Get to school on time before 9:00. I was on time.
The Johnny Soy.
We won the Valley, baby!
But there was a lot of kids that I didn't know. And, you know, to get a kid to listen to you, you gotta first get a kid to like you.
But, I mean, I got to earn your trust to listen to me. But I put the time and effort into the player. I get it.
It was new to me. With some of the faces were new, but I knew a lot of the core players. And with working with Tony, him and I were like, it's like riding a bike. He knows me. I know him. He finishes my sentences. I could start his stories.
I'm not completely displeased with practice. Are you displeased with practice?
It's the greatest day of my life.
The one thing that stood out was the scheduling. Practices started later than we expected. Games were a lot later than we expected. And, you know, as a program, you know, coming up with a schedule, we wanted to play the best teams that we possibly could. And the games that we wanted to play out of our schedule that was given us, like we always want to reach out to tough teams. So we set up a good schedule. We had a good squad, and it was about just learning the team and getting back into the swing. But the schedule was tough. The practice schedule was late. Games were late. And that threw a little bit of a wrench into just kind of the season. It was, that part was a little bit exhausting. Don't go to war with the army you want, you go to war with the army you have.
Trust us. Trust the process.
We are going to run our opponents into the ground, and we are going to out-talk our opponents.
When you have nothing left, you still have something left.
We have an opportunity to set things right.
One of the things that we've always had with lacrosse here at Rondout is it is a culture.
The best part about coaching is every team, your dynamics of a team is going to be different. You have the very serious teams. You have the teams who wear their helmets on the bus going to away games. You have teams that aren't even changed by the time they get to the field. This team was like a little bit of a mix of everything. The personalities were strong.
But we've always, you know, one of my favorite songs that I had on our playlist. We are like a league of peculiar gentlemen, you know. Lacrosse guys have a tendency to be a little eccentric and a little different. We march to the beat of our own drum.
They're a unique bunch. I'm a nickname man. I give lots of nicknames to players. We had a lot of young guys. We had an eighth grader. We had Jack. We had Tristan Post, Soda Pop, and Jack the Ripper. They're eighth graders, and they fit right in. Great personalities. Lucas Ospina stands out to me, the Chubacabra. That guy, you talk to him for 5 minutes, and I don't know, man. He's just a unique soul. Brady Morse, Morse Code, another, you know, a line of the Morses coming through the Rondout. Tyson Mead, that guy's a stud. We got it from Montiora. That was nice. Ben, I love Ben to death. There are times I look at that boy, and he would just look at me and say, Coach, I don't get it. And I knew that Ben didn't get it at that moment. Fry, I got to give you a Fry. Fry was one of my favorite players, the coach. The kid competed. He showed up every game. He was a gamer, played offense, played defense, could shoot the lights out of the ball, tough as nails. He did a lot of time sitting next to me in the penalty box. And him and I had some good conversations while he would sit in the penalty box. But he played with a ton of heart and a ton of pride. Bowman, I love Bowman. Bowman we counted on for a lot. Trey was someone I didn't know before, and Trey was a unique dude. Huge guy, huge athletic defenseman.
Wu-Tang, Reed Wogan. And I only talk about Reed Wogan. You know, he's another guy. He came out as a junior, right? Sophomore, came out as a sophomore. I was looking for a goalie. We needed a goalie. You know, and Reed was a sweet kid. He came in and, you know, we tried to, you know, we were going to put him in the goal, and he showed up wearing I guess it was like an outfit. It looks like the Michelin Man. It's for goalie, soccer goalies. And by day two, I'm like, son, you got to lose that outfit. But why? It's for goalies. You got to lose the outfit. We found a spot for Reed, and he was a contributor. He was beyond it. In the 2022 season, he was a contributor. He was an important guy to have on the field. He found his niche. Jaden.
Jay Marshall kind of sums it up. I mean, a kid who'd never played lacrosse in his life, his senior year, he wanted to play lacrosse.
Great basketball player.
And he was one of the few people that won a section, two sections in his senior year. He won a section title with basketball. He won a section title with lacrosse.
I said, I really wish they could have gotten you playing lacrosse earlier. And he said, yeah, me too. I'm like, well, come out this year. And he was a great contributor on the pro. Does that mean that he was a huge offensive generator on the field? No, but he brought an energy to practice and an attitude, a positive attitude, that kind of lifts everyone up.
Connor Slinsky, Rambo, funny dude, hard worker, brought great dynamics to the team.
I scream a lot in practice.
It's filthy! What is wrong with you?
You know, and Connor kind of got used to that. They realized I'm just loud. I'm not mean. I can be mean, but I'm not mean. You know, Connor really started to come into his own last year. He was always you know, put in the work, but things really started clicking for him last year. And more, not that his ability developed, his confidence in himself, he finally started to realize, you know, we kept telling him, you can do this, you know, you can do this, you know. And he finally started to believe. It sounds like a public service or like an after school special. He started to believe in himself. Once he started to believe in himself, we had no doubt the things he could do. He just had to believe that he could do those things. Goalies are, that's a different breed. Goalie, they always say this, I'm opening it up to all sports. Goalies, kickers in football, and pitchers, they all have a very similar personality. And to be a goalie is to be a little different. When you think about it, for lacrosse, you stand in a 6x6 cage and guys hurl a very dense, hard ball at you as hard as they possibly can. And you need to make the save or put your body in a position where the ball hits you. And it takes a special kind of person. When we talk about goalies, you know, Alex Bolin.
Bolin cracks me up. He would drink like 10 Red Bulls before any practice or a game.
He didn't grow up playing lacrosse. He came out his junior year and he did everything I asked with no lacrosse experience. Single-handedly, I'm going to say he, on my overall coach, Mahosky, and I always talk about the all-Toko Mahosky team. Alex Bolin is one of the toughest kids that I have ever coached because he had to stand in a cage with no formal training and figure it out in real time, which resulted in getting hit with a lot of lacrosse balls. Again, he brought an energy to practice that, but if I could bottle that, you know, Aiden Demarest, AKA the Milkman.
Milkman, the Milkman. I mean, what else can you say? Probably the greatest name and nickname in nickname history was the Milkman.
He found his spot. He's a face-off guy. He will give you 100% when you ask him. He will do his best to try to deliver what you need. He's a sensitive guy, but not a weak guy. You know, he's sensitive, and it's okay. People would laugh. I'm a sensitive guy. I am. I'll run over top of you if I have to, but I'm also at the same time, you know, I'll feel bad about it later. Maybe. Aiden is that guy. He's, you know, got a great sense of humor. And he's a hard worker, and he brings a certain energy.
Koch, Ethan Koch. If you want to coach any kid in the world, coach Ethan Koch. Great kid, great student, great athlete, tough as nails.
Ethan Koch is another person who they leave nothing in their tank, so to speak. Highly coachable, very athletic, smart, and does what is asked of them the first time. Hardworking in the classroom, but also physically hardworking in person. Tough, physically tough. If Ethan Koch came off the field and said to me, you know, there was more than one occasion I turned him and said, I got to get you back out there, he would go. And so I knew him as an athlete well enough that if he looked at me and went, I can't, I knew he can't go. And very, very rarely, although it happened a couple of times where he said, Coach, I can't go right now, you got to put somebody else on the field. I respected him as an athlete. I still respect him, obviously, as an athlete, but that I knew that when he said, you gotta find somebody else, then he didn't make those statements or choices lightly. He worked very hard. He worked through injuries, he worked through pain, he worked through discomfort, always focused, always gave me his A game at all times, never took a playoff. Johnny Soy, there's a lot of, they call him like lax rats.
What more can you ask for Johnny Soy? That guy's exhausting to coach, to play with, because all he wants to do is run, 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 shoot, 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 play, play, play. He's like a little Tasmanian devil.
Lacrosse is a kind of sport that gets in your blood, and if you get infected with it, it's like there's no halfway. And Johnny Soy is one of those guys that lacrosse is the center point of who he is. You have to be careful with that, though, too, because you have to have other parts of your life. It can't become all-consuming. But if you want to be good at something, you have to prioritize. There's time for other things, and then when you want to be good at something, you have to be fully committed. So Johnny Soy is a guy that's fully committed, right? So that's the mental aspect of it. He's also been blessed with, you know, athleticism and a good brain and a strong family unit, parental units. And when you put all those things together, plus passion, right? He's passionate about lacrosse. A lot of people say he loves lacrosse. No, when you're passionate about it, there's a difference. Hard worker, good lacrosse IQ, student of the game. They do the extra, and it's not a chore. It's a pleasure. You know, going and shooting 200 lacrosse balls at 5:30 in the morning it can't be a chore. It has to be a love, right? A passion. So that's how you get to the, I hate the expression, you know, we talk about it a lot in my household, the next level, right? What is the next level? But if you want to get to the next level, the highest level of competition, you have to make sacrifices and you have to be committed.
But the guy that I have a special place in my heart for is Josh Newman.
Josh Newman, Pumpernickel, Big Country, whatever you want to call him.
I knew when he was like 10 years old he was going to be good because he's a massive human being. He had the will, he had the determination, and so I kind of like molded him and like did private lessons with him.
Josh Newman was a force on the field. Big, strong defenseman, smart, high lacrosse IQ. I'm thinking of a moment, a snapshot in my mind when we were playing Highland and everyone thought Highland was going to be the ones that were going to roll over us. And there's a moment where I watched their big lefty attackman who was going to go to Ithaca. I watched Josh Newman break his spirit. And I don't say this lightly because I really respected that kid as a player, but I watched Josh shut him down for the fourth time and he just quit. I watched him. The ball got taken away. Josh picked the ball up and moved it downfield, and the camera sat on him for a second, and he just dropped his head and rolled his shoulders and slammed his stick on the ground, and he was done. And I remember thinking to myself, he's now taken himself out of, he's no longer an impact player in this game. We've broken his spirit.
And seeing him his senior year kind of like put everything together and be that defenseman I knew he could be.
But Josh and Johnny both got brought up to varsity as eighth graders. I don't think we have the season we had in 2022 without Josh and Johnny, two natural leaders.
The thing that's nice is always, you know, team goals. We always put team first. There's no, you know, there's no I in team. You can't spell team with an I. And we have all those sayings or whatever. And when you win team accomplishments, and it's something that really stands out. But at the end, you know, it takes individuals to build a team. It really does. And we understand that.
I was the first All-American here at Rondout, and it was a pretty cool award because being a trailblazer for future guys, it was cool to have that award for 2 years. Jarek Rawl was the second All-American, and he was a little bit after me. He was 3 years after me. He was a 2018 All-American. And I knew he was going to be an All-American toward the end of his year because he was putting up some pretty good numbers. The least surprising one was probably Johnny.
Athletic All-American Johnny Soy, who's, you know, at times when you'll see some highlights, it looks like he has a cape on him. He's the Superman of our team when it comes to lacrosse on the field.
I knew beginning of the year that he was going to be the best player in the section. Having him be one of the All-Americans is awesome to see due to the fact of the relationship I have with him and his family. And seeing his evolution of the game from when he was a little kid, helping line fields at Rondout with my dad and his dad, watching him grow up, watching him just become the player I knew he'd become. I don't think I could think of as too many other people that are more deserving of that award than Johnny, and I can only expect more out of him. So excited to see what he can do in the future.
However, we also have a Superman in the classroom, and that was Ethan Koch. He was an academic All-American, which is pretty hard to do as well. He was the, you know, number one in our class.
What that really speaks volumes to is the kind of kids that we coach here. We have those double duty kids that are really great athletes and committed in the classroom. They were trying to move away from that, and a lot of us pushed back that your academic All-American just has to play lacrosse, but he doesn't necessarily have to be a good lacrosse player. So for a while there, certain schools were trying to just get a kid to be on their team that was, you know, valedictorian, but let him run around a little bit. And many of us pushed back and said, no, that doesn't pay tribute, because there are true student athletes. So to be the academic All-American, you got to be a really good player, and you have to have that academic bona fides.
We were the only team in Section 9 that had an All-American athletically and an All-American academically.
I had a hard time taking the grin off my face knowing that we owned both of those.
As a coach, as a mentor, as an adult, as a supervisor, whatever, that stuff makes you feel good. That's your payoff right there. You know, that never goes away.
And we've always been inclusive. Even when we were a club here. In the beginning, it was out of necessity. We need players. But that I learned that even at Kingston. When we started at Kingston, we needed to have a certain amount of bodies. And so we became very welcoming to kids that maybe got turned away in other places. And then we would squeeze what we could out of them. And then that kind of just became one of our core values. It wasn't out of necessity anymore. It was that's who we are. There's a spot for you with our program. That's how I've always been. That's how I'll always be. We find a spot for you. We'll find a strength. And you'll be a contributor. If you have the right attitude, we won't care if you've never played before. We'll figure it out.
A unique team of a lot of mix of personalities. And at times, they were kind of everywhere. But they did a good job of meshing with each other. And there were times when Toko and I realized we needed to step back and let them kind of police and take care of themselves when we just kind of watched at times. But they're a fun bunch. They were fun. The Lord's game, the first game of the year, that was one that we really wanted to start off with a victory.
Today, payback starts today, one by one. We start hunting teams down. Today it begins.
I had high expectations, but I was incredibly nervous because this is the first time we're going to take our new team out for a walk after the previous season. It was a tipping point. How are we going to respond to the adversity, right? We went down a couple goals. The positive was we did respond. We didn't pack up our stuff and quit mentally. We kept at it, and we walked away with a W. I think it validated for them maybe a fear that nobody wanted to talk about, that we can play. A mediocre team is the team that wins the games they're supposed to win and loses the game that everyone expects them to lose. And your outstanding team wins the games they're supposed to win and wins some of those games that nobody expects. It didn't matter for anything. It was a non-league game out of the section, but it showed the older guys we can produce offense when we need to.
We started out with a W, and that was kind of like a good way to get our season rolling.
Because that game started to set the tone for the rest of the season. We didn't quit.
I never thought that when we started our club team in 2008, 2009, that we'd be in a room like this on a Friday night getting ready to walk out onto a lighted turf stadium. And you have that.
Take some pride on the front of your jersey. The person to your left, the person to your right, be there. If you're on the sideline, be loud. If he makes a goddamn save, you say great job. If he scores a goal, you touch him and you try to get the good luck rub off him. We need to be a team.
Obviously not happy with the outcome. That's a game that...
It's a game we should win.
We really wanted to win that one. In the big picture, it doesn't affect our seeding or anything. It shows us what we have to work on.
You did not quit playing. At no point did your backs break and you quit. We fought back from 7-2. We fought back from 12-9. I hate this feeling. But I'm not trying to sound all philosophical. Our destiny was in our own hands. We just had to take care of business.
Why is it so difficult to put the ball on the turf when you shoot? Did it go in when we bounced it? I've been saying this for 34 years. Yes, coach. Everyone laughs about it, yet we failed to do it.
You don't have any magic. You guys understand the game. You have to execute.
Peter, he's the one who taught this to me. When you point your finger at somebody else, you got three more pointing back at you. You watch the tape and you watch where the mistakes were and you own there.
Let this burn it.
They're out there dancing. They're dancing. Well, I was gonna film this. I was gonna film it. You're dancing on your brand new fields. And I'm not trying to rub it in. I love each and every one of you. I do. But it's tough to watch you guys not feel the feeling of victory. We haven't had that in a while. A long time. You gotta get there, man. Things to work on.
Everything is going to go as it should. We're going to set the tone and the tempo of the game. Walkill is having a difficult time scoring settled goals. They're not scoring any transition goals. And then the phantom goal, where a player comes up, he takes a deep shot, like an 18-yard shot in my brain. There may have been a push from behind or a slash call. It's a sloppy bounce shot. Brady Morris comes out and makes his save. And I'm turning to get a man down unit on, and all of a sudden the official puts his hands up on a goal, a ball that was never within 2 yards of the cage. And that's where your character gets built, because I'm not blaming Brady, but it's very evident that got in his head, because at that point he was having a hard time stopping a beach ball, because I think it got in his head, and then everyone started to play frantically. You can build and learn and teach and coach off of that. You can't let one play derail your game plan. You have to have the mental toughness to put it behind you. And if you don't, well, what we saw happens, then nothing goes right. You gotta put it behind you. The remainder of that game, Walkill couldn't not score a transition goal. Everything they threw the cage was going in. Now, in coach world, if you're gonna run the table, then we needed to beat them and beat them substantially and then beat them in the finals. I don't believe, you know, if we had won that game by a goal or two, I don't know if the finals ends the way it ends. Who's to say? That's, you know, what is and never shall be. We don't know. But that loss left such a bad taste in everyone's mouth that, and at the same time, gave our opponent a false sense of security. So year in and year out, we would just put clinics on against them, and they would get very frustrated, because we would beat them in very lopsided games. And when I say we would beat them in lopsided games, I would tell our team, you pulled the chain at 19, but I would be playing, after the first quarter, our starters would be out. That we would be beating them with freshmen, and I would have to tell freshmen, did everybody score a goal? When we're done scoring, everybody go to your weak hand. Everybody has to go to four passes before you can attack the cage. When you attack the cage, I want only bounce shots with your weak hand. You know, and then we stumbled a little bit.
So New Paltz got some wins against Rondell Valley in the prior years to this year. And leading up to it, we were pretty dialed in, and we knew what we wanted to do. We wanted to be tight on offense, and we wanted to really limit any of their opportunities. So there was a lot of history with our players prior to that game.
In 2019, we went down 8-0 in the first quarter at home, took them lightly, couldn't dig ourselves out of the hole, and ended up losing by a goal. 2021, see, in 2020, all debts were going to be paid for a lot of the stuff that had happened, and it didn't happen. So then we go to New Paltz, and we play New Paltz at New Paltz. I have no shame in saying this. It was just bad, ugly lacrosse. Two unskilled or, yeah, I'll say it. We struggled because of, you know, 2020. We struggled. Young. They beat us in triple overtime. when there had been some attitude when they beat us the first time. I tell anyone I coach, I can do nothing about the ethics, morals, or values of my opponent. I can only take care of the ethics, values, and morals of my team. You will always be humble in both victory and defeat. When New Paltz beat us for the first time, they did some, I'll say, classless things. They stopped in front of our bench. They did some pointing. They did some laughing. And it was a one-goal game. There were still some debts that needed to be settled. But I'm not saying that that's how we went out. It wasn't, we weren't. But we were a different team than the last time they played us. It was evident very early in the game who was driving the bus. And we would have, at my leadership, we would have done the right thing. I was very close to pulling our starters when we had a 9-goal lead, 10-goal lead. But then it was out of my hands. There was the hit on Josh Newman.
Whoa! To the house!
Whoa! Whoa!
Get up, Josh! Get up!
Get up, Josh!
He's gone.
That's a 3-minute number. He's gone.
Kick him out. Yeah.
Which was uncalled for. It was late. It was targeting, and it brought a serious concussion, and quite frankly, my argument, the game ended very ugly, but the officials really needed to eject the player on a targeting call.
But it took out our best leader, I think our team leader overall, and one of the best players in all of Section 9, and one of our best defensemen that we've ever had. So that was emotional for our players to see our toughest player and our anchor to our defense get knocked out of the game, and he got hit hard. That kid hit him very hard.
He's a captain. He was defenseless, and it was a cheap shot, and so I didn't take my starters out. You watch the tape. Everyone watched the tape. We didn't do anything unsavory. We just continued to play. I said, all right, you got a quarter and a half. Play lacrosse.
The end of that game, obviously the emotions got the best of a lot of the people that were involved in that.
No! No! No!
You don't want it! You don't want it!
John, get over
here. You don't want it!
They were emotional because we put a lot of goals on them, and we were emotional because our team leader got knocked out. You get emotion, you have contact, and you have teams that play with pride, and sometimes you get that. But I think overall, the players and the coaches did a good job of not letting that get any bigger than it could have been.
I don't like games like that because I really truly believe you need to honor the game. You honor the game. For lacrosse, you honor the game. You know, and I take that into any sport I coach. I don't dance on my opponent's graves. I like to win and be humble at the same time. And that game really tested my resolve on doing that, because there's a certain part of your brain that wants to go, no, that's just not gonna pass muster. Never wrestle with a pig. You both get dirty and the pig likes it. You know, a nicer way of saying it is, never lower yourself to your opponent's level, but bid they come to yours. And that's, I was desperately trying just to keep playing the right way, you know? So, yeah, the New Paltz game was a very ugly, very ugly ending.
The O'Neill game was a unique game, and that was a game that kind of, to me, in my opinion, and maybe others, I don't know, but I can only speak for myself, O'Neill was kind of a turning point of our season. We, you know, it was towards the end of the year, so a lot went on towards leading up to O'Neal, but O'Neal kind of summed us up.
Yeah, we're missing two starters. Josh Newman is out on concussion protocol. Johnny was ejected from the New Paltz game, which is still, I still question that, but we, you know, the rule is cannot protest an ejection.
You know, our best player and maybe the best player in Section 9, maybe ever, was out. He was suspended because of what happened in the New Paltz game. So we lost Johnny Soy, and that's, you know, he's good for 6 goals on himself and maybe 4 helpers. That's a 10-point person that you take out of a game. We also had Josh, our best defenseman, out of that game. We had a couple other players. I believe an attackman was out of that game. We had some COVID stuff, and we were down in the hole of that game. I think we were down 9 goals at halftime or something.
And we dug ourselves a big hole. Again, we're going to come back to that first game against Lourdes. We just play lacrosse the way we've been coached.
A testament to us, we just kept pushing. And one thing about our team was that the more chaos that was kind of going on in the field, the better we kind of played it. We found our way in the chaotic plays when the ball was all over and there was a lot of transition. You know, we weren't the best team at being completely settled. But when the ball was getting kicked around and we'd pick it up and start pushing the ball up the field and we were looking to push, we started making things happen. So it was a chaotic game, which kind of went in our favor. And I got to say, one thing that stood out was players stepped up who weren't necessarily in their positions during that time. And, you know, Milkman, Aiden Demarest, he was our face-off man throughout the year, and he did a phenomenal job at that. We needed him on attack. We were down 2 attackmen that game. He filled in at attack, and I believe he had 4 goals that game. He was working off ball. He was doing everything that we wanted an attackman to do. So he didn't look just like a fill-in player. He was actually a really good attackman that game.
It made me feel very proud that we stepped other guys into roles that weren't accustomed to, maybe not, that's their position, but they were never pushed into a leadership role where you gotta step up, as they say in sports, you know, you gotta step up and produce. And we went down. Well, we were in a huge hole with missing 2 key starters, 2 captains. And we came back and we won the game. And you know you've done it right when the opposing coach shakes your hand at the end of the game and says, "I have a lot of respect for you. Wow, you know, my hat's off to you. That was a phenomenal comeback, coach." He wasn't angry with us. He wasn't angry with his team. It was what it was. But we came back. That's in the record. That's in the Rondout record book as the biggest comeback, and I think it's in Coach Toko's record book. I don't think I ever had a comeback like that in Kingston.
The team pulled together, goalies were making saves, people were picking balls up, moving the ball, and we came back, and the momentum, we won that game. We snuck that one out. That was the second section champion from Section 9 that we beat. We came back and beat them, and that's a testament to our players on that one. I mean, we didn't do much coaching, but just kind of keep guys fresh and keep, you know, just keep the hot hand. Hopefully the ball was going through their stick, and guys stood up. When you take away a Johnny Soyou and take away a Josh Newman, who do you have left? Well, you know what? You watch that game, you realize we had some players that stepped up and took on the personality of being the leader on offense and the leader on defense, and that's a testament to the heart of the players that we coached.
It's validation that if you do what, when, and how, and not only do you have to do what, when, and how, what we tell you, when we tell you, how we tell you to do it, the ball's going to bounce your way, but it's a validation that there's no guarantee. But if you'll hear me in tape after tape, year after year, just keep playing, just keep playing, just keep playing, just keep playing. You got to keep the throttle to the firewall. You got to keep going. There's no guarantee it's going to, it's not a formula. Oh, then you'll definitely win, but you have a much better chance. And those situations, the Lawrence game, the New Paltz game, the O'Neal game, they verify and validate for you. If you're persistent and consistent, good things are going to happen more often than bad.
You know, Tony and I coached at Kingston together. When I came to Rondout, Tony was the head coach at Kingston. And he hunted me down and said, "Hey, I want you to be my assistant at Kingston." So before all of Rondout started, Tony and I were coaches together at Kingston in 04 and 05. So we have a connection there. We have a connection with Danny Barnes.
Danny Barnes was a, one of my best players ever coached, great human being, great person. You know, struck down early in his life when he was doing great things with just a fluke, rare. He's 1% of the population that skin cancer is a death sentence for.
Danny Barnes was a great player at Kingston. He was just a brilliant, beautiful person. Tough as nails, smart as hell, respectful. Just the person that you want your kid to maybe grow up like.
We snatched a couple of the first trophies the Danny Barnes game early on. Some of the first games, very exciting. The stadium was packed. The other side was packed. It was crazy. And then we had some dark times where we just, you know, they kind of rolled us.
Kingston is a game that you circle on your schedule. And that was one that personally I wanted to win for the program, for myself, for the Barneses, for Toko, for myself, for Rondell, for that rivalry.
We dug ourselves a hole. We got down by 5 goals. And I thought, all right, maybe it's just not meant to be. I don't want to say destiny, because that means that regardless of what we do, it's taken out of our hands, destiny. But it was the way the season was going to play out that we don't quit. We don't quit. And we didn't quit. And we came back.
Nothing's given in a sport. Nothing's given. And hard work and us just paying attention to detail and Johnny knocking a ball down and picking up and scoring for, I think that was his 7th goal of the game.
Everybody get a man!
Come on, Johnny!
Yeah!
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 Let's go!
Yeah!
Yeah! It's either the instant it goes in or as it's happening, I turn because I already know the game's over.
And that way to end it, you know, that's in the book, that looks like he pinned the corner or, you know, that was a beautiful goal. But that's just hard work, knocking a ball down and you know, working hard and just refusing to lose. And that kind of was our motto there. And we battled, man. We battled.
I was just super pumped up because that's just a special game for me because me, Dan Finkbeiner, and Andrew Coons were the driving forces of the original Danny Barnes game. So that game always has kind of a special place in my heart.
Game ball, the entire team, for 2 games. You fought back from a 12-5 deficit to win a ball game, and you just took it to the almighty Kingston Tigers, right? What just happened? That just happened. Game ball is going to this team, and I want to put it with that trophy. I need somebody to make sure.
Right?
We're going to put it right there, and we want to put the score, and it's an OT win. Everyone owns a little bit of this ball.
Let me see it. Yep. I disagree, and this is why I say so. This man right here has given to everyone in this room more than they probably deserved. He's given to me more than I deserve, not just in lacrosse life, in personal life. He's been with me through many, many letdowns and many, many really celebrations in my life personally. He will give. He was supposed to go up to Brown. He came here and stayed here for the track meet. Where things, if you knew what was going on behind the scenes, there was a lot of riffraff behind the scenes with money, how to pay people, and it got kind of ugly. But he blew off his family to be here for the greater good. Regardless of what happens next year, he wanted to keep money coming into this program. He puts everyone in front of him at all times. And I refuse to let him put everyone in front of him for this. So, Danny Barnes is someone very close to him, the Barnes family. I'm glad that I was part of that era as well, and it's nice to see them out there. This ball should go to Coach Toko on his mantle, on something. I refuse to have him give this ball up. I want him to take this and be selfish.
Thank you, and it's going to go somewhere special. I just am so proud of you guys. I'm not going to keep saying it all, but understand how proud you didn't stop playing.
Me too. Good job.
Stop
feeling good. Rambo.
Yeah. Yeah,
Rambo. Rambo. Yeah.
Connor.
Could have swore I said at the end of the game, we want to make sure we shoot at different levels. You know what? As an educator, I should know. I should differentiate sometimes, make sure I can use multiple avenues. Changing levels means shooting lower.
I'll be nice to the kid. Rambo.
I wouldn't bust your hump if I didn't love every one of you. When I stop talking to you, that's when you got a problem. Understand that. When I stop talking to you and you're transparent, that's a bad place to be because you are now inconsequential in my life. All right, none of you are there.
What time's practice tomorrow?
Practice tomorrow, 5:30 a.m.
Yeah! Friday, practice. I'll be there. Fine.
Yes,
coach.
5:30. That's the one man who does whatever I say, he does it. If I said you have to smash a banana on your helmet and then scream like a monkey, he's like, he said, how loud, coach? All right, so tomorrow's practice, regular time, let's go 4 to 5:30. Get loose, right? Monday, I'm not gonna say it's a walkover, but.
It's a walkover.
We see what happens there, and then here's the scary thing, and I told you guys this when it was blowing windy and rain and 40 degrees, the season's gonna go like that. Well, the season's done.
2 weeks left, right? 2 weeks, about?
We got the train's rolling, right? Train's pulled out of station, train's rolling. Building momentum. I'm gonna roll over everybody. All right? Let's get out of here.
Keep it rolling, guys. Good job.
Get in your post.
Let's go.
Good win, boys.
1, 2, 3.
Rondo!
More fences!
Family!
In my coach brain, there are probably, I could give you 5 games, not just lacrosse games. There's a football game in there, too. The 5 outstanding endings of a game. Kingston Rondo win. Just the way it went down is probably number one. We're giant killers. You know, I oftentimes call them grandma fights. You get in a fight with somebody's grandma and you beat the snot out of her, everybody goes, so what? But if grandma beats your ass, it doesn't look too good for you, you know. David and Goliath, we're David. Kingston should roll us. We beat him like that. That was a very sweet win. In 2019, we were going to win that game.
And
we
were
playing Walk Hill. And you know my feelings about Walk Hill.
There has to be some backstory, though. Because there is friction between us and Walk Hill. It's 2019. We're the 4 seed. We're playing the 1 seed, which is Walk Hill. They had some good supporting players, but their coach had one standout. And as the game went on, that one standout who I had a real lot of respect for, he started to wear down because he was on their man up unit. He was on their man down unit. He was their face off mini. He was their clearing mini. And to put a kid through that kind of physical expectation, I saw, we went down a bunch of goals. We're the 4 seed, it's a grandma fight. But we start chipping away. We start coming back. And now it's a 4-goal game. And now it's a 3-goal game. And after we scored our 3rd goal, the opposing coach called his timeout. called our guys in, and they're all riveted to me, right, laser beams on me. I said, take a look at their bench. Just look at their bench, and then come back to me. And their bench was in complete chaos. Everyone's running around, everyone's yelling, go, we're gonna win a ball game. He burned one of his two timeouts so he can rest seven. And they don't have a plan, so here's what we are gonna do. We're gonna force that player to handle the ball as much as possible. If the ball ends up in his stick, you're gonna lock everyone else out, and you're gonna pressure him. You're gonna make him handle the ball consistently. Don't let him get off the field to. And it's kind of a conflict of conscience. But it's strategy. You know, it's strategy. And so there's some turnovers. The kid is really, he's exhausted. And now it's a 2-goal game. And now it's a 1-goal game. And they burned their last timeout. I have no timeouts left. Comes in and I say, here's what we're going to do. We're going to tie the ball game and then we're going to win it in overtime. So Caden is going to win his faceoff. He's going to get the ball over to the far wing. We're going to push the ball up through Sam Serrano and we're going to hold the ball at X. And Caden is going to come over here and he's going to turn in his faceoff stick and he's going to get his game stick and we're going to run one play at about 15 seconds. We had a set play. And we're gonna tie the ball game. Unless opportunity presents itself before that. Don't force the ball, but if opportunity presents itself, take your shot and we'll never die right here. Ball's whistled in the play. Caden wins his face off, just as I'd scripted it. He jogs over, right? He gives the ball to Sam Serrano. He jogs over to the box. Alec hands him his game stick. And the opposing coach starts screaming, illegal stick substitution, illegal stick substitution. They blow the ball dead and award it to Walkhill, where I have to call a timeout, a table timeout, to contest the call. And the official came over and said to me, it's an illegal stick substitution. The stick has to come through the box. I said, the stick did come through the box. We start to get into it. He's like, we're not doing this. He whistles the ball into play. There was maybe 30 seconds left. We have to double the ball. We end up committing a penalty. And the game dies on the vine, 1-goal. And then there were some words between me and the opposing coach, who, when he shook my hand at the end of the game, I wouldn't let him walk away. And I'm like, really, an illegal stick substitution? He's like, yeah. I go, you're gonna tell me that you coached at the collegiate level for 7 years and you don't realize that the stick just has to come through the substitution box like a player? The player doesn't have to come off the field? And he said, well, that's the official's call. I said, you knew the right call. He said, it's not my job to do their job. I said, so you admit, you worked the officials. You know what, if the game, winning that game is that important to you, then it's all yours. You know, but you know that's not the case. Long memory, right? Click.
All right. And then 2020, no season. And then last year, we definitely, like the Phoenix, reborn from the ashes. I think we got Walkhill right where we want him. Your focus has to be ruining Walkhill's season. You're going to ruin Walkhill's season.
Ruin it.
And I say that with as much animosity as I possibly can. No. I say that from a good place. For us, ruin their season.
Yeah! 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 Let's go, boys! Yeah! Okay, you guys are not hyped. That got me ready.
No,
you guys
we're
are not.
Finish. Finish.
Hold it, but hold it. 1, 2, 3!
4, 5, 6!
Got to listen to me
and take this to heart. You cannot buy in to the bad call. It's got to go behind you, myself included.
You stay a moment, you stay focused, and you depend on the guy who decided to, which has been one of our core values in this program forever.
It only goes one way.
You have to put everything else behind you.
We have one game. It couldn't have been written better for this man right here. The team that he wants to play against. We have one game to accomplish the goal of being a section title. When you're tired today, you need to suck it up. Don't make a mistake for being tired and not putting that extra effort in to get your ass back on defense. Let's be tough. Let's worry about the name on the front of us. And this is it. We have four quarters. I know from these games, the first quarter is gonna fly by. Let's get this done. This is where we make it up to the last year.
And the game got delayed because of a rainstorm. So that game, we had to come back into the locker room, and then we had to actually go home and come back the following day. We knew on that bus ride coming back to Middletown that we were going to win that game.
I love you guys. And your job is to love each other. Play the game for the guys on your side. Most importantly, we want to have fun. When you're putting your efforts more to benefit your teammate, and everyone has that same mindset, we don't play our potential. We exceed our potential. You're a human being a lot longer than your lacrosse player.
At the end of the day, you want to be able to look in the mirror and be okay with who's looking back at you. We're a tough team.
We're here, we leave, we come back, nervous is over. Take care of business, let's get our year in Raptors, kids.
Stewart cranked the shot off the crossbar, and Johnny snagged it through the air and buried it. There was maybe a minute left, and Walkill called the timeout before the faceoff. So I brought everybody in and I said, he's going to double the ball. He's got to double the ball. He's going to pull the goalie. He's going to double the ball. If we win, if we get the faceoff, he's got to double the ball.
We don't need a G. We have a ball for 1 minute with one less man. Don't let a goalie cover you.
When we won the faceoff, 40 seconds, they're not doubling the ball. 30 seconds, they're not doubling the ball. We end up scoring another goal, I believe, in this chaos.
Jack!
Let's go!
Let's go!
Will!
Let's go!
Because the Walkill kids finally said, we got to double the ball. They tried to double the ball, and they didn't have a plan, right? You always have to have a plan. You have a plan, right? A goal without a plan is a wish, right? But when I looked down to their bench, I turned to Mahosky and went, he's done. He doesn't know what to do. Look at their bench, and their coach was just, he didn't have a plan. He did not know what to do, and I said, this is even before we scored the go-ahead goal. I'm like, we're going to win this game. We're going to win this game.
Yeah! stepping up, kid.
Yes! I love you guys.
Guys!
Thank you, Benny. That was awesome. Good job. I love you so much.
You can't take that from us, boys.
Yes, sir.
To the rafters.
We got everything to lose now. I am so proud of you guys. You never stop playing. Let's go, we want to stop.
So keen on fate, but it's almost like somebody wrote the script for the whole season, from Lords to Kingston to O'Neill to Walk Hill, because Walk Hill, that goes all the way back to 2019. Oh, and by the way, I got a call from the official to apologize to me. We were sad when that game ended. There were some tears because it was kind of ours. So, told everybody, by the time you get to the bus, no more tears. It's a game. We move forward. And so, my cell phone rings, and the head official, who wasn't doing our game, he's doing a different game. He's a friend of mine. He's like, hey, John, you okay? I said, I've been better. He's like, yeah, I just got a call from, I'll leave him nameless. Who's another good guy? I like these guys. Called up and said, what's the rule on exchanging sticks? Well, as long as it goes through the penalty box. Like a sub, do they have to come off the field? No, they don't have to come off the field. Just the stick has to be passed through the substitution box. Why? It's like, I blew the call. You blew the call. Was it a close game? Yes. Please don't tell me it was Rondout. Was it the Rondout game? Yes. Was it against Toko? Yes. He's like, I don't want to be you. You know, and the other official, you can ask Sam Serrano. As the call was happening and being done, the other official said to Sam Serrano, you know, your coach is right. That's not an illegal stick exchange. But I said to that other official later, you had a mouth. You could have come over and went, no, stop. If that doesn't happen, if the Phantom goal in 2022 doesn't happen, the sectional title doesn't happen. Wait a minute.
I knew that this was going to be his last go-around, and I told him, like, this is the team to do it. If you're going to do it, this is going to be the one.
You can't top that. That's why you got to listen to the lacrosse gods, right? Got to know when to hold up and when to fold up. I love my teams. You know, that's one of the things that we say. And some people look at you like, you don't really say that. You know, what do we say? What's our job as coaches? What's my job as coach? To love us. Yes. And what's your job? To love each other. Love my teams. And it was a hard decision. But it's time. You know, it's time.
What I'm going to miss most about the varsity level coaching is obviously my relationship with Coach Toko. Tony and I have been friends way before we've been coaches, and we'll be friends way after we're done coaching. So that's head and shoulders above the rest. Tony knows more about me than, I don't know, there may be one or two more people in this world that know more about me than Tony Toko. He was there for me in times when I was down. I'm there for him in times when he's down. So our relationship is a lot more than just coworkers, coaching partners. We go way deeper than that. You know, we're blood brothers before we are coaches. So most importantly, I'll miss Tony the most. However, he's still texting my phone and we still talk a lot. So I do miss the ability to coach with him. He's got a great brain when it comes to lacrosse and just everything in general. It's always great to be a part of, you know, Rhondda Valley Lacrosse. And, you know, you'll hear Toko talk in his interviews about, you know, we're people. I'm sure he'll say, you know, we're people longer than we are lacrosse players. And that's something we really try to instill in our players. And, you know, you put the stick down, but you still continue to be a human being.
And for the rest of your life, you got to be a we us person. That's the part I'm going to miss, where I can impact my players to be the best people that they're going to be.
And I'm glad I'm part of it. I still keep in contact with lots of ex-players.
It's always hard for me to talk about Coach Toko as a coach, because he's also my dad. But I always kind of thought like his coaching style was normal because I lived with him. Like, I couldn't get away from him. And so being out of the house now and being around other coaches, I now realize like how great of a coach he is/was, because not only did he know X's and O's like no other, he teaches life lessons that you can take throughout the rest of your life and sets you up to be successful. Some of the lessons and memories and other things I learned from being a player of his has made me the coach I want to be now. And I can guarantee that all the other guys who have played under Coach Toko for at least a year could attest and agree with that statement. I know I wouldn't be the coach I am, or the player, or the employee, or person I am without being a part of Coach Toko's sphere. And it is sad that this was his final season, but I know there's no other way that the season could end without a championship. And I mean, he's the best that's done it in this program, so I know it is going to be different. I know I'm going to be a little selfish. I'm happy that he's finally retiring, so he can come to Providence and watch some Brown lacrosse now and be more a part of my lacrosse sphere now. And it's funny that kind of like a storybook ending, one career ends, another begins. So when my dad's coaching career is ending, mine is, and my sisters are finally beginning. So I know for a fact that when I become a head coach at some point down the road, which I know is going to happen, I'm going to be able to take the life lessons and the coaching styles that I've learned from the coaches I've worked with, but also Coach Toko's.
I'm glad that I was part to see Rhondda Valley take off before we were a team, then we're to a team. And like I said, the Kingston atmosphere, when I turned around and looked at what we created, it was something to sit back and go, wow, you know, nice. Now let's keep this Gander Nation rolling, and you know, it's established. Let's see how far it can go. And that part's nice to be part of the foundation of it.
I keep telling the athletic director, I keep telling Coach Panic, whoever takes over the team, I'm handing them the keys to a Ferrari. Just don't crash it. All you got to do is steer it. Don't crash it.
I'm really excited to see how the culture kind of adapts to the new coaching styles. And kind of the things that continue to happen going forward. And I know there's been a team culture that has been established and has been passed on. So I'm excited to see how the culture continues to be passed down for the guys who are playing youth lacrosse now up until when they're seniors. So I'm excited to see how that turns out. I'm excited to see the growth of the sport in the area. I'm excited to see where these guys end up going, who are currently playing, to where they're going to play at the next level. So, I mean, it's only going to get better from here. I know that for a fact. I know we have people in the program that are willing and will step up to continue the legacy that we have created here. And I know Coach Toko will always be a part of that, even if he's not the head coach of the varsity program. I wouldn't be surprised if you see him running around at youth practices, still maintaining the culture we've developed. So I don't think you'll ever get him away from this program. It's kind of his baby. Kingston was kind of his, but this was his program from the very beginning, so I don't think you're ever gonna get rid of him. But I'm excited to see how the future of this program continues to grow.
You know, I would love to have one more season with those guys, but it's just, it's not the right thing. That's going to be hard. Because I enjoy being around my players. It's a joy. It's fun. It's like you get to be a kid again and you get to play. You get to laugh. You know, I love to, anybody who had me as a teacher knows, I like it to be fun. I don't mean goofy and not serious, fun. It takes no skill to work hard. Whatever you do, do it to the best of your ability. It doesn't matter if you're sweeping a floor. Have pride in what you do and how you do it. And take care of the people around you before you take care of yourself, and you'll be all right. If you can keep your head when all about you are losing theirs and blaming it on you, if you can trust yourself when all men doubt you, but make allowance for their doubting too, if you can wait and not be tired of waiting or being lied about, don't deal in lies, or being hated, don't give way to hating, and yet don't look too good or talk too wise. If you can dream and not make dreams your master, if you can think and not make thoughts your aim, if you can meet with triumph and disaster and treat those two impostors just the same, if you can bear to hear the truth you've spoken twisted by knaves to make a trap for fools, or watch the things you've gave your life to broken and stoop and build them up with worn out tools, if you can make one heap of all your winnings and risk it on one turn of pitch and toss and lose and start again at your beginnings and never breathe a word about your loss, if you can force your heart and nerve and sinew to serve your turn long after they are gone and so hold on when there is nothing in you except the will which says to them, hold on. If you can talk with crowds, keep your virtue, or walk with kings, nor lose the common touch. If neither foes nor loving friends can hurt you, if all men count with you, but none too much, if you can fill the unforgiving minute with 60 seconds worth of distance run, yours is the earth and everything that's in it, and which is more, you'll be a man, my son.
If you're gonna be dumb, you gotta be tough. When you get knocked down, you gotta get back up. I ain't the sharpest knife in the drawer, but I know enough to know. If you're gonna be dumb, you gotta be tough. I lit my brain with rot gut whiskey till my pain was chicken fried. And I had dudes with badges frisk me, teach me how to swallow pride. I took advice no fool would take. I got some habits I can't shake. I ain't the sharpest knife in the drawer, but I know enough to know. If you're gonna be dumb, you gotta be tough. If you're gonna be dumb, you gotta be tough.